Herb. Herb is a plant. I mean, herbs are good for everything.
Welcome to Eugene Cannabis TV. You made it to episode 692, and we're all by myself today. We had a couple of guests coming in, and apparently they couldn't make it, so hopefully they'll be here next week. But I got plenty of information to put out there, and I'll be sure, first thing, I keep forgetting to bring this up again, but Eugene Cannabis TV, we could use a hard drive for our main computer that our, and we need a 2 to 3 terabyte hard drive for a desktop, a Mac actually. So anyway, boy, if you've got one out there, we could sure use one. It'd be a big help to us. We don't have hardly anything involved as far as big dollar wise to produce this, but we do need some help now and then. And this is the one that we've been needing for quite a while, because video, it takes up a lot of room on a hard drive, and so when you're doing a half hour a week, it adds up. And so anyway, I just wanted to put that out there again, that we could sure use a computer hard drive, a 2 terabyte, 3 terabyte size. This day and age, and that's not a lot of money, but it's more than we have in our pocket. So anyway, you could use that, some help getting that if you could do that. And the biggest important announcement today is, on this show, is coming up October 4th. I want to announce that. That's the Oregon Cannabis Commission Listening Tour. It's actually coming to Eugene, which is kind of a rare thing, because when they had the ACMM, which is the advisory board for the medical marijuana program, they traveled around the state too. But for some reason, it seemed like they just didn't get to Eugene very often. And well, thank heaven the ACMM is gone, because it was a paper tiger anyway. But now we have the OCC, and that's the advisory committee for the Oregon Medical Marijuana Program, and we supposedly help us work with the legislature to get things fixed. Maybe, as I like to say, I would like to see them do things for the patients for a change, not to the patients like they usually do. But so far they haven't figured out how to turn that train around. But anyway, so that's very important. It's October 4th, and it's listed from the state as being 4:30 to 5:30 p.m., and it's at the Atrium Building in Eugene. That's 10th and Olive, and that's our friends at Compassionate Oregon is advertising, saying that it's starting. They want you there at 1:30. So I've put a word into them, and I haven't heard back, and I'm not sure why they're saying to be there at 1:30. But again, the official announcement said 4:30 to 5:30 is, okay, let me back up. I'll tell you what it is. That's it. 1:30 is when the meeting is starting. Okay, that's it. And then the public input is at 4:30. I think I figured it out. So basically, come any time between 1:30 and 4:30. I'd say put it that way. If you'd like to see part of the meeting or be there part of the meeting, you could do that. But the public input will be at 4:30 to 5:30. So very important. We need patients. Well, anybody that's pro-cannabis and pro-Oregon Medical Marijuana Program, you don't have to be a patient to participate. But patients are the ones that really need to stand up, because they're the ones that are being affected, like myself and many others, and probably many that you know out there. Very, very important. For instance, you know, they're trying to, the OLCC is trying to reduce the limit from 28 ounces to 1 ounce. Anyway, it's a very despicable thing that they did. And they're saying it's temporary, so it remains to be seen. But anyway, that's the kind of thing that we need to get input back from patients, because in the history of the Oregon Medical Marijuana Program, the state has dragged their feet on helping patients, and nothing's changed. And so we still need to keep fighting for the program. So anyway, don't forget about it. I'll try to bring it out before the end of the show, remind you again. But that's October 4th. It's on a Thursday. It's on a Thursday. And hope you can make that. So I wanted to have a summary of the OLCC meeting that I talked about last show, that happened on September 19th. And this is from the our friends at Cannabis or CompassionateOregon.org. This is from them again. And this is a report on it. They're saying that we packed the room. Everyone there did a great job. By the way, I got reports that there were as many as 100 people that showed up for this. So that was very cool. It says the green and red cards Andrew brought were in full view and helped support those at the table. What that's about is that they had orange or green and red cards, and then when somebody said something that the patients or people that were supportive in the meeting would agree with, they'd hold up the green cards, or if they didn't approve what they was going on, they hold up the red cards. That way you could let people know what you think, but not disrupt the meeting. So it's a pretty good tactic from what I understand. And by the way, it mentions Andrew, that's Andrew Gwynn. Anyway, which is the chairman of the Compassionate Oregon. And so he said, you can tell from this meeting, there's a lot of passion from the cannabis community, especially when fighting for patients. Patient advocates, industry, and others invited to provide feedback by the OLCC were in favor of a full repeal of the rule and had a hard time getting through to OLCC that 24-ounce purchases, I earlier said 28, I was mistaken, it's 24 ounces, the 24-ounce purchases from patients are justified and legitimate. Many argued that multiple purchases or larger amounts is what patients need. This is especially true if they are making other cannabinoid products such as tinctures, healing balms, and lotions and oils. This concept seemed hard for the OLCC to grasp, and the more the panel members insisted it was acceptable, the harder the OLCC contended it could not possibly be so. Many at the table raised the issue of OLCC's role in limiting patient access in the first place. It also emphasized that patients have lost their growers and have been forced into OLCC stores and are now being told they can only buy a very limited amount on a daily basis. This is no different than in the OHA dispensaries being unable to meet the needs of consumers when cannabis was first made available and they were limited to selling only 7 grams per purchase. It was also not lost on those at the table that the patients should be left alone until an investigation has been completed and the bad actors had been identified and dealt with appropriately. Most of the invitees at the table also noted the lack of consumer data and couldn't the general buying public could be doing the same thing just in smaller quantities in more stores. This led to a discussion about tracking and that without the needed adjustments to the system to ensure purchases by consumer or patient were tracked accordingly, this would continue to be a problem. At the end of the meeting, the invitees called the OLC's claims wildly unfounded and agreed that the rule should be repealed. Consideration could be given to limiting the number of large purchases a patient can make over any time period, and language could be included to allow a physician to recommend a patient be allowed to exceed statutory possession limits if and when necessary. The rule is temporary and will sunset in November regardless, and many invitees expressed concern that such a long period could harm patients and suggested it should be added to Friday's agenda of the whole commission. Compassionate Oregon is working very hard to ensure that patients' access is returned and patients can again purchase the amounts they are legally allowed to possess. So again, we need to go to the OLCC listening tour, and that's at October 4th at 1 p.m. It's I mentioned that there's a little error on the address. It's 151 West 7th, and that's room 258, and that is the Atrium Building, for those of you in the Eugene area. Thank you for your support, and please keep up our Facebook page for updates and upcoming events. Please consider making a donation today to make our efforts successful. You may do that at CompassionateOregon.org/donate. So that's one of the field groups and a large amount of people that are trying to help patients. And so they definitely need the support if you can do so. The And then here's the article. It was on the Oregonian and Oregon Live on the internet on the same subject. Medical marijuana patients decry state crackdown on pot purchases, written by Noel Crombie on September 23rd. Noel Crombie is the Oregonian author, reporter that reports on cannabis issues. She writes, in August, a state analyst spotted dozens of suspicious transactions when he crunched cannabis sales data. A small number of medicinal marijuana card holders bought unusually large amounts of marijuana flowers on consecutive days. Oregon regulators suspected medical marijuana patients and caregivers were exploiting the system by buying cannabis to sell on the illicit market. The response was swift. The Oregon Liquor Control Commission, under pressure from federal officials to tackle the robust black market for marijuana, quickly issued a temporary rule that dramatically reduced the amount that medical marijuana cardholders could buy in a day. The limit dropped from a pound and a half of marijuana to 1 ounce. The same quantity recreational cannabis consumers are allowed to buy. What we saw was abuse, clear abuse of the standards, Steve Marks, executive director of the Liquor Control Commission, said Wednesday. After 19 days medical marijuana patients decried the state crackdown on pot purchasers gust. For instance, one medical marijuana card holder bought nearly 13 pounds of cannabis. Another bought 7 pounds over 10 days that month. Officials said the questionable transactions came from a small percentage of cardholders, and that the typical purchase was for most cardholders 4 grams or less. Mark said marijuana program overseers worried that the state's low marijuana prices enticed some cardholders to stock up and take it to Iowa or whatever and sell for a profit. We saw that happening, he said, adding it was a little bit of a Ponzi scheme. Oregon has been in the crosshairs of U.S. Justice Department leaders for not doing enough to crack down on the black market. U.S. Attorney Billy Williams has repeatedly expressed frustration with the state's failure to maintain production, and he's chided top officials for not devoting enough resources to oversight and enforcement. On Wednesday, patients and advocates for the medical marijuana program blasted the new limits at a contentious meeting of the state's Rules Advisory Committee. Advocates said medical marijuana patients sometimes need large amounts of the drug to make products they rely on to treat their conditions, and they accused the state in meddling with medicine. The Rules Committee, made up of marijuana industry participants and advocates, called on the Liquor Control Commission to restore daily purchase limits to 24 ounces. The at times boisterous crowd included some of the same activists who have long championed Oregon's 20-year-old medical marijuana program since its early days. For many, the rule reflects the latest change to a program that has experienced a steep drop-off in participation since voters approved recreational marijuana in 2014. So we're going to continue this in the second half. We're getting close to the break. I wonder I got to come back on this story and we'll talk about some more about.
Do you suffer from fear of losing your election? Are you terrified that voters will discover you've done nothing to improve their lives? Maybe it's time you talk to your spin doctor about Incarcerex. In clinical trials, Incarcerex has been shown effective at reducing election-related anxieties by making voters think you're doing something about the drug problem. It's simplistic and fast-acting. If your problems continue or get worse, you can always double or triple your dose of Incarcerex. Whether it's addiction, therapeutic use, or just casual use, there's an Incarcerex plan for every American. Best of all, taxpayers, not you, will foot the bill. So talk to your spin doctor about Incarcerex today. Common side effects include loss of civil liberties, police corruption, racial injustice, increased terrorism, spread of HIV and AIDS, and violent crime. Bloated prisons are also a common side effect. Stop taking Incarcerex if bloating lasts longer than 20 years. If you're trying to balance the budget, keep families together, or protect human rights, Incarcerex may not be right for you. Do not mix Incarcerex with the Constitution or common sense. So start taking Incarcerex and keep pretending you're doing something about the drug problem.
Welcome back to the second half of episode 692 of the Eugene Cannabis TV show. You got Dan here, and DanK, or DanK Bagman. It used to be DanK Bagman. I'll let that slip out. I was going through the story on the Oregonian, written by Noel Crombie, titled Medical Marijuana Patients Decry the State Breakdown on Pot Purchases. And continuing, state statistics show Oregon has about 39,000 medical marijuana patients, down from 78,000 in 2015. The number of grow sites serving three or more patients has also plummeted from about 4,000 in 2015 to about 800 a day, according to Anthony Taylor, a longtime advocate. Cannabis is tax-free for medical marijuana patients. They also are allowed to buy more potent edibles and oils than recreational users, and until the latest rule change, they could buy more cannabis flower. It remains a vital program to those who remain, supporters said. Brent Kenyon, a licensed producer, processor, and retailer based in Medford, accused regulators of scapegoating medical marijuana cold card holders for black market diversion when recreational producers do the same. You cannot punish everybody for a few bad actors, he said. You can't do it. It's not good policy. During a particularly tense exchange, Jesse Sweet, the lawyer who has helped draft the state's rules for Oregon's legal marijuana market, asked Dr. Rachel Knox, a member of the advisory committee, to explain why one person would need so much cannabis. I need you to explain to me why a patient needs 6 pounds of flower, he said. Knox countered by saying the state had no proof that the transactions were linked to illegal activity and wouldn't rule out that one person could have a legitimate medical need for a large quantity. It was a claim that Sweet found incredulous, using an expletive to express his disbelief. Sweet, the administrative policy and process director for the Liquor Control Commission, then got up and walked out of the crowded meeting. He eventually returned and apologized for losing his temper. Marks, after the meeting, struck a diplomatic note saying he was encouraged by the lively discussion and some of the advocates' proposals, including allowing patients to buy more marijuana based on the doctor's recommendation. We're going to look at it, he said. We are listening. So, but let's not forget he lost his temper. Okay, apologize for it. But the point is, anyway, the OLCC should not have anything to do with the Oregon Medical Marijuana Program. That's, we've been saying that since the get-go, since this whole stupid idea came about. And the Oregon legislature, as I've said for many, many years and continue to say so, that the state of Oregon in general, Oregon legislature in general, doesn't like marijuana. They don't like marijuana people. They don't believe in medical marijuana. And it shows and continues to show. So, again, October 4th, people, we need the numbers. You can see in this meeting we had about 100 show up and really pushed back, and that's what we need. It's a big, big pushback. Back in the day when we were first had them starting out with the medical program, we had a fairly good turnout of patients, and I realized patients are sick, so it's kind of hard for them to get out and about. But still, unfortunately, that's what needs to be done, is because we got to fight for what's ours, and the fight goes on. So anyway, that's real important. And I next I wanted to do a real quick deal on the this was in Willamette Weekly. The new revenue coalition is pushing lawmakers to legalize social cannabis consumption. This is written by Lauren Ishiko, is on the WillametteWeek.com website, and that's September 11th. As the laws stand now, legal consumption of cannabis is not allowed beyond the walls of your own home or another private residence. But the new revenue coalition believes consumers deserve more than house parties. Led by Sam Chapman, co-author of the House bill that legalized medical marijuana dispensaries in Oregon, and Anthony Johnson, who co-authored Measure 91 to legalize cannabis, the NRC is organizing efforts to make social consumption a reality. A political action committee also believes the state is losing out on the economic growth and tourist dollars that could be gained by allowing regulated common consumption outside private residences. And to mention that it unfairly punishes users who don't live in places where consuming cannabis indoors is allowed. Willamette Weekly talked with co-founder and co-director Anthony Johnson to learn more about the PAC's mission, why cannabis farms should be allowed to offer in-house tastings, the same as vineyards, and how complacency is a major hurdle than Oregon's Indoor Clean Air Act. Anthony Johnson: the main objective is to bring more fairness and equality for adults and utilized cannabis, especially low-income patients. Too many people don't have a safe place to legally consume cannabis out of public view due to their rental and housing agreements, which disproportionately impacts people of color and folks suffering through poverty. The bonus objectives are to create more jobs and revenue by allowing for consumption within cannabis businesses. Who benefits from laws allowing social consumption? Legalizing and regulating consumption spaces, which will be in private establishments out of public view, will greatly benefit low-income patients and others that utilize cannabis without a safe place to consume. It will also benefit entrepreneurs and taxpayers by boosting our local economy. Oregonians that don't consume cannabis or don't even want to be around it will benefit, not just from the overall economic benefits to the state, but also from fewer people smoking cannabis in public. Why is this effort significant for tourism and the state's economy? We've already witnessed economic benefits from legalizing cannabis that have far exceeded initial projections. Boosted by tourism dollars, we will lose tourism dollars to Canada, California, Nevada, and other locations that allow cannabis cafes, spas, bed and breakfasts, and further business development. Licensed farms should be allowed to permit sales and consumption on site, emulating a model similar to wine tours today. What challenges does the coalition face in completing its mission? The greatest challenge is anti-empathy because too many people might think that ending most criminal penalties and legalizing retail stores are enough. There is still a lot of work left to ensure that we provide safe access to patients and implement regulations that truly treat the cannabis industry like our local breweries and wineries. What about the Clean Air Act? The Indoor Clean Air Act doesn't even apply to topicals and edibles, but it's been an overarching reason for social consumption to be prohibited. Prohibiting cannabis cafes actually encourages people to eat edibles and smoke in public instead. How can people help? People can help by volunteering, make a donation to our lobbying efforts, and spread the word on social media. The work is only halfway done with cannabis legalization in Oregon. So I'm fully in support of what they're doing and what they want to do. However, what I do have a problem with is that the majority of these people working on this are in the medical marijuana field. But you notice that wherever they're following the dollars, because that's the big thing now is that, for instance, we have two cannabis clubs that I know of, one in Portland, one in Salem. They're private clubs. You pay a charge admission and you can go. So they're there now. But this will make it more mainstream is the word, and make it easier to do, I guess you'd say. So again, it's a good thing, but it's just that it really irks me because these people that worked on the medical program are turning their backs on patients, basically, because we just reading the story about the Oregon Medical Marijuana Program is dwindling up because of the larger legislature and the rules that they've been making. And then these people there, they quit working on that. Now they're working on trying to get the business set up so that their friends can make money by opening cannabis clubs, you know. Well, that's a good thing, but at the same time, what about the patients? And so it just irks me that they continue to turn their back on patients, you know. And it's just very, very hypocritical. One of the main people, not mentioned in this article, but you can bet that she's up to her armpits in it, is Madeline Martinez, which is a board member, a national board member of Normal. And is a past chairman of the Oregon Normal, which is the one and only local Oregon Normal chapter. Anyway, she had opened the world famous cannabis cafe that was up on Sandy, and I ran that for a number of years. Nice facility. I was there a couple of times myself. But there's one fact that nobody ever talks about, and they talk about how, oh, we need this for the patients, we need this for the patients. Well, I got a news flash for you. The cannabis club in Portland that Madeline Martinez is pats herself and her on the back for wasn't open to patients because it was in the basement of a building with no elevator. So, but nobody mentions that. They just talk about how wonderful it was that she had that and how she did that for the patients and how great it was, and then but patients couldn't use it. So just a little side note that you won't hear anywhere else. So anyway, I wanted to talk about our friend Elvi Musica, who's been on the show multiple times, and this is one of her tins. She is one of only, I think it's four medical marijuana patients that are living yet, might be down to three now, and she receives one of these tins every month. It has, I think it's three, 300 cigarettes, approximately 300 cigarettes per can. They're all pre-rolled and they're second on in. And this is what they come from. So this is actually came from the federal government. So she's looking for a donation. She's gotten thousands of dollars for these before, and this one is available, and she could use help. Financial help, because she really is an advocate for our beliefs and our patients and freedom in general. So if you'd be interested in getting, this is a historical item, I'll tell you what, because like I said, this came from the government with pot. And so get a hold of me, DankBagman@hotmail.com, and we'll see about getting you hooked up with that. So thanks for being here tonight, and we'll see you next time. I'll be here. I hope you